broadcast.
Low life. There's a power available life, there's a powerful life, but there's a power flow life, right? And God wants us to have all of that power. So, like, how do you know when you're full, though? Yeah, as people talk about, how do you know you're full? Let's go to Acts chapter 2. If you grace me to just flow and you know, write down some of these scriptures, search the scriptures to see if it's so for yourself. But Acts chapter 2, it says, and when the day of Pentecost, verse 1, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all on one accord, one place. Something about being in agreement in the Spirit of God. Something about being in agreement. Two or more gathered in his name, there he is in the midst, is what the scripture says in Matthew. In verse 2, it says, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And said, and there appeared unto them, look, cloven tongues as a fire, and set upon each of them, right? That's that outpouring showing up in the room. And it says, and they were all, look, filled with the Holy Ghost. And how did they know they were filled? And it says, and began to speak with other tongues. Oh, yeah, speaking tongues. Somebody told me that was of the devil, right? But we already know. We done been in the world. We ain't seen nobody speaking in tongues, so we know that ain't true. But it's still something that hard to wrap around your natural mind to. So sometimes it's hard, like we run from things that we can't control with our mind. It was hard for us to float, right? Like, well, to this day, transparently, I still don't swim. Because of my first experience at camp. They put me in the water and they said float. When I laid on top of that water, I'm trying to grab for something to hold on to. And I'm falling in the water. I'm fighting. And it's like, come on, this took me out the pool. And, you know, it was a traumatic experience for a young fella. I was like, I ain't going. Now, and that's it. My wife would tell you, I love water. I love going around the water. I've been out in the middle of the ocean on a jet ski. I was just trying to do stuff where I wasn't in control that day. I ain't tell her. I just did it. You know, I was like, I'm on the ocean. I said, this is my first time on the ocean. I said, I'm going to follow and do what they do, you know, because I had never been on a jet ski, you know. So then I got out there, and I was going slow at first, you know, like just coasting out there. Then I said, you know, because I love water, I was like, Lord, I'm out here in the middle of the ocean with you. So then I got, babe, how you going to be telling the story? So then I got confident first. And so they had this buoy way out. I was like 500 miles, I don't know how, 500 feet or whatever. It was way out. I was like, well, I'm going to go out there. And so now I'm rolling, you know, bouncing off the water. You know, I was just rolling, right? But I got out there, and I deal with what's called depth perception. Perfect. I see 20/20 out of this eye. This one, I can't see nothing if I close it, right? And so it affects my depth perception. You know, this is a wonder I was a pretty good basketball. I was a pretty good basketball player. So I got out there. I turned around. I couldn't see the wherever the raft was that you're supposed to go back to, I couldn't see nothing but water. I said, uh-oh, I don't know where I'm at. I had no sense of direction, northwest, east, or south. I said, now, the story's going to be young minister gets lost out in the sea on a jet ski. You know, I said, well, Lord, I'm just going to trust you. I'm going to just go in the direction you lead me. For real. Now, I could have been just going further out in the sea. Obviously I'm here. I got back. Right. But I said that to say, the jet ski was holding me up. It wasn't me, you know, and I had never done that before because I haven't learned to float. We took some swimming lessons last year. My struggle still was floating. Now she's like, let go, relax your stomach. Natalie, exercise. Come on. Like, I can't, you know, I'm used to holding my stomach in, right? Like, so I was like, y'all just messing up my whole groove right now. You know, like, I don't even know how to do it, you know. So sometimes that's how it is when it comes to the Holy Spirit. We're so used to being in control, holding stuff in, it's hard to just let go, right? It's hard to just flow. But this unknown tongue thing here, let's go to 1 Corinthians 14. You know, but look here, it says 1 Corinthians 14, 2, it says, "For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit in the spirit he speaketh mysteries." Underline, circle, highlight, however you do it in your Bible, or write down in your notes, "He speaketh mysteries." Right? So we're gonna spend some time. That's why it's called Mysteries Revealed, right? And so it says he's speaking unto God, but not unto men. So some people says, "Well, I heard the person in church talking. I heard him." Yeah, but they were talking to God. Now, if they come up here behind this pulpit and they start talking, they're trying to edify you. But the scripture says here, is it the next verse? Verse 3, it says, "But he that prophesied," that's speaking in the gift of tongues with an interpretation. "He that prophesies speaketh unto men to edification, exhortation, and comfort." So if I step back here and start speaking discernment in tongues, there has to be an interpreter so you could be edified or built up or comforted or encouraged, right? So it's two different types. See, verse 4, "He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself," builds himself up. "But he that prophesieth edifieth the church." Prophesieth is, 1 Corinthians 12, it's the gift of tongues and interpretation together is a prophecy. All right. So that's why, I'm going to let y'all, when on your own time, just read through 1 Corinthians 14 and it breaks down the difference. Two different things. One is me speaking to God in my heavenly language, right? Because I'm filled with the Spirit, right? And we're going to explain what's being communicated out of my mouth here in a few minutes. And then one is edifying the church. The gift falls on me as the Spirit wills. And because God wants to speak something that I wouldn't be able to articulate myself if I tried. It's coming from God himself. I'm almost neutralized. He takes over this body, speaks in an unknown tongue, and then gives the interpretation either to me or somebody else. My wife may come up and go and start speaking what God was saying based on that prophecy of tongues. Does that make sense? All right, so work with me here. So when you pray in tongues, the Spirit speaks directly to God, right? Prayer is an exchange of communication. It's a communication change. It's a communication exchange. But listen, it said, "Howbeit in the Spirit, we speak mysteries." So what's happening is in this communication exchange, there's supernatural problems solved and mysteries revealed or made clear. Because our life sometimes is a mystery. Now, interesting thing about this is 1 Corinthians 13:12, it says, "Now you're looking through a glass darkly, but then face to face." So like you're looking in life as looking in a mirror. You ever get out of a shower, you look in the mirror and it's kind of fogged up, even though you're trying to see your face. When the mirror clears, you see what? Face to face. So when it says, "Now we're looking in the glass darkly." So whether we're young or old, sometimes it's like, I don't know. It's so uncertain. How is this going to work out? What's going to happen in my junior year, my senior year? What's going to happen in college? What's going to be the next move on my job? What am I purposed here for? Something's pulling on me. Why am I going through this? What this is saying is these mysteries start getting clearer and clearer. See, that scripture, 1 Corinthians 13:12, it says, "Now when you're looking for," we can go there real quick. We can come back. It's just the next, 1 Corinthians 13. It's just the next chapter over. Before he got to start talking about tongues and interpretation and speaking mysteries, before that, he was breaking down love. And he was saying, listen, "I speak in tongues and men, rather speaking tongues and men and angels, I'd rather walk in love." He was saying love, everything has to be girded in love. It has to be about people, not just about, "Look, I speak in tongues," right? And then he went into saying, "When I was a child, spake as a child, thought as a child, and when I became a man, I put off child's things," in verse 11. Then verse 12, if you read here, verse 12, it says, "For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face," right? The picture's not clear yet. It says, "Now I know in part." I don't know the whole picture for my life yet, even though sometimes I'm prideful and arrogant and act like I know stuff. I'm not fully clear, right? It says, "Now I know in part, but then I shall know even as I am known." In the Amplified version, that says, "As I'm known by God." So it says, now things, as I get closer and closer to God, things get clearer and clearer. 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says, When we get into this word and we get in with God, it says we're holding ourselves in the mirror and we're changed into His image from glory to glory. So there's a level of glory we have, but as God wants us to evolve into wearing His glory, His full power. We're going to get into that. So He doesn't want us to just have, you know, the glory of the world, which is limited, and it can only draw people to us. He wants us to have the glory of God, which will draw people to Him, right? You have me so far. That's 2 Corinthians 3:18. All right? And so mysteries get revealed. Things start getting clearer and clearer the more we start operating in this, infilling this power. The Holy Spirit, what happens is the Holy Spirit is on the inside of us. He's communicating with God from your vessel, right? God is talking through the Holy Spirit to your vessel. So again, He's praying through your vessel, magnifying God, and He's communicating with God. Communication is an exchange. Just like if you pray to God, you're talking to God, but I hope you're listening because God's talking to you. Like, prayer can't just be, I go make requests or I go talk and then I leave. It has to be some quiet time, right? Some silence where you're listening to God. Like why go talk to somebody and then walk away? Like, you're going to ask for answers or solutions, and you go, well, I need to understand this, I don't understand that, why is this happening, this, that, and the other, and then you leave. And then you go, I pray to God all the time. I ain't getting no answers. Did you stay and wait for the answer? Right? Jamal said, you don't pray, you say to God. Right? But prayer is an exchange. So even when the Holy Spirit, who knows how to pray better than us, He's having an exchange. And the good thing about His exchange is, He's speaking what you can't articulate. You know how sometimes you just don't know what to say or what to pray. Like, you, especially if you're in the situation. Like, if you're in a situation, it's weighing on you so much, you're like, but that's not what I meant. Well, that's not what I'm trying to say. Oh, me and my wife, you know, we'll be talking sometime. She'll say something, I go, and she'll tell you, I take you literally. So if you open your mouth, I'm taking what you said the way you said it. And I'm listening. Ask her, I listen to everything you said. So then I said, no, baby, you didn't say that. You said this. No, that's not what I meant. Well, that's what you said. You know, in the early years, that caused arguments. You know, now I'll say, okay, well, this is what I heard. She'll go, okay, that's not what I meant. Let me rephrase that. The early years, you don't get a chance to rephrase because I'm trying to win. So if I'm trying to win, you know, like, I can't let you rephrase because I just won. You know, you rephrase, I might be wrong. Right? But if we go through that, imagine, and sometimes she worded things wrong out of respect. There's a level of reverence and respect for me and how I flow. I've worded things wrong out of respect for her. I don't want to say this wrong because she's going to go in on me. Imagine how we all be when we come before God. Then you're going to talk to God. This God now. You know what I'm saying? So you're like, man, I better get this right. You know, because I'm talking to God. And I got a small window here. Sometimes we don't know what to say, but the Holy Spirit... Praise the perfect prayer. Now, what's included in that prayer? It's the problems that need to be solved. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is here, so we keep our momentum going. We keep flowing. Right? Because we get stifled in life by, they hurt me. They hurt me. Remember we did teaching on the victim? They hurt me. Help. They hurt me. Like we get stuck because we hurt. And then we play off of, yeah, I tell you what. Yeah, they're going to pay. Yeah, but who's paying? First of all, they don't even know they're paying because they ain't around you. But you have stopped your momentum. Your light affliction is but for a moment in time, but worketh for you a far more exceeding weight of glory, power. So instead of you using it and converting it into power, you're letting it weigh you down and stop your momentum. So you take the circumstance and the pain and you pack it up and you just carry it everywhere you go, right over your heart. Just carry it everywhere you go. But it happened in a moment. Leave it there. It's a light affliction, but for a moment in time. Don't take the moment and turn it into a lifetime. Right? So again, you have these things that start to weigh on us. And, you know, just start to restrict our ability to flow. And the Holy Spirit said, I got you on this one. Because you don't even know how to communicate the problem. You can't even get it out. Because you're thinking about, I can't believe they played me. They betrayed me. They didn't think about me. They left me. How could they hurt me like this? Holy Spirit said, we can't. Yeah, listen, dude. Yeah, you know, you watch. Remember the first time my son hurt his ankle. So when I came out on the court, I'm whispering to him. I was like, son, you're going to be fine. It's going to hurt for a while, but then the pain is about to go away. Now I'm schooling him on it because I know how he felt. Because the first time I hurt my ankle, I felt like I was going to die. But I wasn't going to die. It's just I never experienced that pain before. It's like the first time I got poked inside my eye. I was like, okay, this is it. I'm going blind. Probably never be able to see again. And it was painful. You see what I'm saying? So I was teaching them what? How to press past the pain. So the Holy Spirit goes, oh, it seems like it's insurmountable. It seems like it's over. He said, no. But the Holy Spirit is doing what I did with my son. Come on, man, we got to keep on going. Listen, I'm going to give you some solutions to keep your momentum going. So I'll talk to God for you. Share the problem. He'll give back intel to help you keep on moving, right? And he'll give you, because you know, like if you don't know what to do, you feel hopeless, right? When you're hopeless, you ain't moving. But if you get new information, you feel hopeful. If you're hopeful, you keep on going, right? Right? You rolling with me so far? And so that exchange is the Holy Spirit getting information. Now, Let me do one thing. Let's leave Corinthians. We're gonna come back to Corinthians, but let's go to Romans 8.
Right.
Okay. All right. So Romans 8:26 says, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. You know, there's some weaknesses we have. It says, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Now it says we should, but we just don't. It says, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered, that we can't get out. That's Bible, right? That's not Pastor Keith's opinion. That's what the Bible says, right? And look, verse 27. Look, and he, the Spirit, and he that searches the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to and harmony with the will of God. So he said, he knows what God's will is. He knows what your purpose for. He knows what your problems are, and he's having that exchange to make sure your problems don't stop you from keeping momentum with God's will. See, because the scripture says in Romans 8:28, all things work together for good, for the good of them that love God and are called according to and harmony with his purpose. Not what you want to do, but what God wants to do. So the Holy Spirit is interceding, right? That when you're filled up and you're speaking in an unknown tongue, talking to God, Holy Spirit is speaking out communication, pouring stuff back in you. And then when it comes out of you, you're speaking out mysteries. The Bible says you're snared by the words of your mouth. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. Proverbs 6:2 and Proverbs 18:21. So God knows you. Your voice is powerful. You've been designed to frame, change, create, decree and manifest things based on what you say. You can bind or loose things in your life based on what you communicate. Right? All right, so that's why the Bible says think on these things. You can have whatsoever you say based on what you're believing in your heart. Right? All right, so that's Romans 8. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 2, which is so interesting. The choir, this is one of the choir scriptures that was in harmony with one of the songs that they taught here, because I know this is probably not walking around with tissue inside. All right, so 1 Corinthians 2, and we'll do verse 9. Didn't y'all read that earlier today? It says, look, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither has entered into the heart of man. So the natural man can't process it. Right? The natural man don't even understand it. Right? It says, eye has not seen nor ear heard. Because you know how you say, I can't see this. I don't understand it. Right? Because it's hard for the natural man to understand it. And it's hard for the eyes to even, is this real? Come on, this is too good to be true. Right? It says, but as is written, eye has not seen nor ear heard, neither entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for them that love him. So God has something prepared. He has this purpose, this plan, and this will prepared. But it's kind of hard for us to wrap our minds. So sometimes we'll bail out before we've gotten there because it's like, man, no, that's not going to happen. And then why believe it's going to happen when I can settle for this right now? It's easier to get this right now in this in compromise than to keep on moving towards what God wants me to get in covenant. I remember years ago, I was telling my son what he was purposed and called to do. And I've shared this before where my son was like, how do you know, Dad? How do you know? I mean, he was upset. I wasn't telling him nothing negative either. But he was articulating what some of us on the inside articulate. Okay, if you're right, what it's gonna cost me to get that means I can't keep doing what I'm doing now to settle for this. If you're wrong, I'm gonna give up what I'm willing to settle for now in these moments of pleasure at the expense of what later? I don't know, man. At least I'm having a little bit of fun. Why give it up? And we just had this conversation. Me and my son just had this conversation. He's 40, the 41. He'll be 41. He'll be 41 in July. So we just had this conversation. I said, remember that conversation? He said, Dad, I remember it. Yeah. I said, all makes sense now, don't it? He's like, yeah. I said, so now you realize God has so much more for you. You know, and he has so much more for all of us, but God can't get some of us to embrace the preparation for the purpose. So he sent us the Holy Spirit to keep nudging us and give us conviction when we get outside the lines, outside that narrow way, right? To give us almost like a distaste when we're not in God's will. You feel empty. Something's missing. To make sure you're thirsty and hungry if you're falling short of his will. And keep giving, he'll give you dreams and visions so you'll see beyond what you've been seeing. That the dreams and visions you'll see might not seem real because they haven't existed. But at one time, flying planes didn't exist either. Imagine having a vision to fly in a plane. These guys running off of cliffs and stuff like that. And everybody else looking at them like, these idiots think they're going to fly. Like they birds. We flying all over the world now. At one time, a light bulb didn't exist. 1,000 tries. But he saw something no one else saw. There's been stuff in you that you see. No one else has seen. And sometimes I let nobody know about this. Nah, what? What? Whatever you want to do, I just do this. But the whole time, you got this cooking back here. Well, I don't want to put it out there because people going to ask me questions. Some people going to doubt me. They're not going to believe. God told you to build the ark. For what? For rain? It ain't never rained. What is rain? I mean, study it out. They had never rained. Can God get you to build the ark in your life? In your generation, can God get you to build the ark of purpose in your life? Even though what you're building it for, the need that you're building it for hasn't manifested yet. Would you still do it? Years is going to, it's going to take you years to build now, and everybody's going to be laughing at you. You're a joke. People are going to walk by, watch you build it. Idiots still trying out there. Building this apartment complex, saying it's gonna rain. Fool. In this particular case, he risked them calling him a fool, but what did it cost? What did it cost the people that called him a fool? Their lives. Some people might not believe you, but it's gonna cost them their lives. They're gonna bail out. They're gonna run from the vision because it's taking too long. And they're going to run to something that's more shiny. And it's going to cost them their life. All right. So just keep that in mind. So again, this Holy Spirit, look, it says the things that God prepared for them to love them. Verse 10 says, but God has revealed them. He's talking about these, the eye that have not seen is not entered in the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for them to love them. But, right, God has revealed them, the things that he's prepared for us, by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. So when the Spirit is talking to God, he's going deep into God's archives to his plans for your life. So when the Holy Spirit starts to fill you up and speak things out, communicate things out, he's speaking out the mysteries that was the deep things that God has planned for your life. And once you speak them out, like, everything starts to hearken to the word. Things have to conform to the word. Why do people talk to plants? So they can continue to grow. Plants absorb sound. They absorb sound and they move based on the sound. Plants are alive. They're not dead. They absorb. All right, do this. Get a plant, play rock music for a month. Well, I don't want you to do that because then you're going to go crazy. You're going to be... You can come here just as dark as you could be. I don't know how you're going to do this one. But it's happened. Somebody played all crazy rock, devil worshiping music. The plant died. Had worship going in the house. Plant's alive. It's absorbing sound. See, when God spoke things into existence, he spoke out sound and everything around him moved. He saw darkness. He said, let there be light. And light moved and showed up. Let there be a firmament. Let there be this. God spoke things into existence. This is Genesis 1:1-26. Then he said, hey, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. Then he spoke man into creation. But after his likeness, how is his likeness? He spoke creative words. The Bible says the worlds were framed by the word of God. Hebrews 11:3. So God framed his world with his words. When God saw darkness, he didn't go, man, it's all dark up in here. I can't believe it's dark. Satan done came down here, turned the place dark, made it void. Now, one time did you hear God speak what he saw? He spoke what he desired. His response to what he saw was what he desired. Let there be light. Our response to the crazy should be life, not amplifying the negative. Magnifying the problem. Just because you feel pain don't mean you gotta speak it. How about by his stripes I'm healed? Right? Okay, all right. So keep that in mind. Keep that in mind. You know, so you got this exchange going on. You got God through the Holy Spirit is speaking mysteries revealed. Now, what is these mysteries reveal? Let's go to Jeremiah 1. This conversation, another conversation I was having with my son. In reference to his life, but in reference to all of our lives, but Jeremiah 1. Look at this. It says, verse 4. It says, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. I had an intimate relationship with thee. Before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, set thee apart. And I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Now, this is before Jeremiah was even in the womb. He had an intimate relationship. There was plans designated, a design, a purpose. There was a path set before he was in the womb. So Jeremiah didn't become a prophet when he became a prophet. He was a prophet before he was even birthed in this earth. Right? That's why, you know, that's why sometimes you're in situations, all of a sudden you start speaking stuff out, you be like, where'd that come from? And then you swallow it back up, you know, because you're like, nah, people ain't gonna really want to go for that. A lot of times your design starts to speak out without your permission, because it's really who you are, right? And so when the Holy Spirit is going and having this conversation with God, when he comes back and he's filling you up, he's filling you up with the intel from the intimate relationship you had with God before you were even entering this earth realm. And so me and my son was having a conversation and we were talking about hindsight. I said, son, you know, I said, if you look at your life, when you're outside of God, you get clouded. You're looking through a glass dark, you get clouded. And I said, so you start to complain, you start to trip, you get defensive, can't nobody tell you nothing, and you start to get desperate because you're operating in fear. So you just, you, and then once you make the one mistake, then in fear you make another one, and in fear you make another one, and in fear, but you're always trying to do the things you can see. You're not even tapping into the unseen realm. You can't even see God, can't see what your purpose to do. You just settling for what you can do, not what you were designed to do, right? You're settling for success and not fulfilled, right? And so I said, son, I said, as you're pressing to God, what happens? The trigger goes off. And in hindsight, you start to, all the information that was downloaded in you, you start to pull them. I said, the life you're living out training. Training before the foundations of the world, training that you got in our house that you might not even thought you picked up. My son does stuff that he's seen and don't even realize he's seen it. He's in Ohio. He ain't here. He's an usher. He's working out. I couldn't get the dude to go work out. He's a college basketball player. Like, son, like, you want to come with your dad to work out? I did. Yeah, he working. He ain't even trying to play college basketball. He working out. But he's seen some things. He's following a pattern. He's picking up hindsight. Why? Because now he's pressed into his presence. He's filled with the Spirit, and the Spirit is triggering intel, information for what he's purposed to do. Even though sometimes we try to run, that's the flesh, because there ain't nobody in their right mind running from fulfilled. Only the flesh would be stupid enough to do that. The Spirit is indeed willing, the flesh is weak, right? All right, so you got this downloaded information, right? And scripture says in Matthew 13:11, it's given unto you to know the mysteries. You're supposed to, it ain't supposed to be a mystery to you. It's given unto you to know, but if you don't have that the Holy Spirit, not just indwelling, but in filling you and pouring out, speaking out the answers or the solve the problems, it's going to stay a mystery, and you're going to get frustrated. And then when you're frustrated, what do you do? You get desperate. And when you get desperate, what do? You settle for it. You make fear decisions, not fake decisions. It's decisions you believe you can control, but it limits what God has for you. So temporarily you feel good, but then after a while, it was a great decision. I'm using my wife. So wife gets a job. Baby, I just really think I need to work for this company. I need to leave this company and work for this company. Okay, babe, I'm going to just flow with you. So she gets a job. Babe, this is a wonderful atmosphere. I just love that. 2 weeks later, man, these people crazy. Babe, these people are crazy. And so the first time, I wouldn't say nothing. I was just like, okay. So then, babe, I got to get out of here. I got to move on to another atmosphere. She goes to another atmosphere. See, that's what I was saying, babe. This is a whole lot better. These people were tripping. They're tripping. I just love this atmosphere. Couple weeks later, babe, these people done lost their mind. They done lost their minds. What happens on the front end? It all seems good, but if you making a decision based on circumstances, the devil have you all over the place. And temporarily, it'll be good for a while. But you have to be led of the Spirit. They done led of the Spirit of God, all the sons of God. The Holy Spirit will show you things to come. He'll show you exactly what you're supposed to do, exactly where you're supposed to go. You'll have a knowing, you have an unction from the Holy One, and you know all things. 1 John 2:20-21. You have this, you know that you know. Even though everything around you is saying, it ain't ever rained, why are you building an ark? You know that you, I use the ark. God told us to move to Charlotte. We've never been to Charlotte in our life. We had $1,625 to start a church. We had relationships, and university relationships, ministry relationships, basketball relationships, all types of relationships. We had a huge church. God said, go to Charlotte. Okay. People were afraid for us. With the exception of my sister, she was just like, oh, you ain't going nowhere. I just put that on there for you, so when you see that. She's like, North Carolina, yeah, right. Not that she wasn't about believing, it was about, my little brother ain't going nowhere. That's what it was about. But God said, come to Charlotte. And no matter how the circumstances look, God, matter of fact, we was driving, because we got played. I'm not going to get into that. But when we was driving, God said, what I have for you, I have for you. So we're playing off of the knowing of what God said, not what the circumstances are saying. Circumstances screaming. Turn around. Go back. You can start with a couple of hundred people out there. Why would you go here and no one knows you? What, are you lost your mind? You've invested all this time in these relationships and you're going to leave familiar and go to unfamiliar? but I was playing off of the knowing. We were playing off of the knowing. That knowing, it be screaming. When the circumstances be screaming, knowing is louder. Trust me. Do what I tell you to do. Right? All right. So keep that in mind. I read Jeremiah, Matthew 13, 11. I gave you that. It's giving us to know the mysteries. So it's the thing about the Holy Spirit. Because somebody was asking this the other day about the Holy Spirit and like the Old Testament, you know, because they were filled with the power, Acts chapter 2. But the Holy Spirit is all through the Bible. So in the Old Testament, it wasn't, how could I say, it wasn't in them. But people got impartations. You know, in 2 Samuel, it says the Spirit of the Lord spake by me. 2 Samuel 23:2. Isaiah 59, it says the words I've put in your mouth. So the Holy Spirit was imparting words in people's mouth all the time. The scripture talks about David speaking in Mark 12:36. It says David was in the Spirit, inside the Spirit. But we got it better than David. The Spirit is inside us. See, remember, power available. Not waiting on the Holy Spirit to be imparted into us for that temporary situation. Then we got to hope he imparts into us. You know, we got to give up 7 rams, 16 turtle doves, you know what I'm saying? And to take that to the priest, hope the priest is sanctified. And when he killed it on the brazen altar, then go to the brazen basis, clench that stench off, then go before the holies of holies. Did it take? Hell yeah, go through all. Nah, we ain't got to go through all that. We have the Holy Spirit within us. We got access, right? We have access to power. You know, power available. So it's a little different. Let's go to Acts chapter 19. We're about to wind down here. Acts 19 verse 1, it says, and it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, talking to the Ephesians, he says, and finding certain disciples. Now, he didn't say people that had given them life to the Lord, people that just go to church. These are disciples. That's another level. They're not at the altar just saying, okay, I accept Jesus, hopefully I'm going to heaven. No, they're actually disciples. They're learning and growing how to operate in the kingdom life, like we were talking about this morning in the Master Life discipleship class, right? So he says he came to certain disciples, right? He said unto them, these are disciples. They already believe, and they're pressing in to live for God. He says, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? Right? And they said unto him, we have not much so much as heard whether there be a Holy Ghost, which is a lot of people in the body of Christ. And he said unto them, like, it's almost like a rhetorical question. Like back in the day, in the BC days, folk coming to me, you don't get high? He's asking a question similar. He said unto them, unto what then were you baptized? Baptized, submerged in. And they said, unto John's baptism, water baptism, baptism of repentance. So verse 4 says, then Paul said, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, and when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. So they spoke in an unknown tongue to magnify God, and they were prophesying. They were speaking with the gift of tongues at the same time. Right? These were already believers. But Paul was like, oh, no, you ain't get the whole everything. I mean, if you a disciple, you need to have some power. You need to be filled up. You need to have access to getting answers to the mystery, because as you try to minister to people, which they was doing, you're going to have obstacles and hurdles, mishaps. Things are not going to go your way, and it's going to look like you're blown it because you were going in a certain direction. You invested everything there, and it's going to look like it's over. It's done with. They done took you out. You done wasted time. He's saying, but the Holy Spirit will show you, clear up the mysteries and keep the momentum going. We'll let you know, like when Joseph was in prison, oh, you a slave? That can't stop you. Let me just give you the picture of what God showed. Then he went to prison. No, that can't stop you. No, God still got something planned. You're going to be a prime minister over everyone. So just keep on rolling. Holy Spirit will keep revealing to you how it works out for your good. It seems insurmountable. It seems like you've blown it. It seems like you've missed an opportunity. But no, no, no. The Holy Spirit will show you and he'll reroute you. You know how GPS reroutes you? But the interesting thing about a reroute, it don't spend all this time talking about how you made the wrong turn. Like, you know, the GPS don't do that, do it? You make, oh, man, Gerard, I told you to make a right, man. I told you exit 145. Does exit 146 look like 145? Man, it's simple instruction. In 2 miles, three, I counted down for you, Gerard. You missed the exit. Man, see, you know what? I don't even want to talk to you no more. It don't do that, do it? Hey, it'll talk to you as if you're still going in the right direction. When you get to 146, get off at the exit and bear right. When you get to Broad Street, make a left. Enter freeway 85 at the left. When you get on, and it's sending you exactly where you're supposed to go, even though you done made a wrong turn. If you're on a street, you know it'll turn you around without saying, man, turn the car around. I mean, it don't even make no sense, man. Just turn it around, man. It don't even say that. When you get to the corner, make a right. At James Street, make another right. When you get to Brown Street, make another right. It just turned you around by moving you forward. That's how the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit's your GPS. It'll just keep moving you forward. You will get to your destination of fulfillment, which is the goal, if you allow the Holy Spirit to show you things to come, keep you moving forward. The only time you won't get there is if you stop. Man, I missed the turn. Gerard, you is your exit 45. You missed the turn. You stop the car, pull over. Man, I missed the turn. You call your wife. Yeah, I missed the turn. Again. Yeah, just missed the turn. I can't believe I missed the turn. I missed the turn. You're sitting there for an hour talking about how you missed the turn. You're not accelerating, rehearsing the missed turn. You're not going to get to your destination, right? You got to keep moving forward, right? And that's what the Holy Spirit would do for our lives. And this is, so this right here is saying that they were baptized. When he laid his hands on them, it said they was baptized in the Holy Spirit. So basically, the baptism of repentance is you're bathed in the cleansing of sin. What's she at? Justina was baptized last night, right? So what took place is the old person went down in that water and was buried, right? And the new person, the new man, came up out of the water. So know what she was doing? She was cleansing that old man off. Like back in the Old Testament, that brazen basin after the brazen altar was to cleanse off that death. So she done killed the old man and his deeds, but she had to be washed of that funk, right? We just call it that spiritual funk, right? Right. So that's what that baptism does. So this says that baptism. He says, okay, you got the baptisms of John. You cleanse off the sin, but he said, now I need you to be cleansed from the weakness. See, baptism, the Holy Spirit gives you power. He says, so now I want you to be cleansed of the weakness. So basically, you're bathed in power when you're bathed in the Holy Ghost. You're bathed in power. Remember John chapter 5, I believe it's verse 1 and 9, when God was at the pool. An angel came by and it said he stirred up the waters with power. So anybody that stepped into the pool was healed. So this man sitting there, and Jesus comes by and goes, you're dealing with an infirmity, and there's a pool right next to you where everybody's getting healed. Why you just didn't get in the pool? I've been here. What the victim? What nobody? Where nobody? Put me in the pool. I done made mistakes in life. I don't know if I deserve the pool. Well, I was on my way to a scholarship and I got injured. So I figured I didn't deserve any power. I'm just sitting here. I figured by osmosis, the pool would just jump out of the water and come on me. I didn't know it was something I had to do. What you trying to say? You think I'm trying to make fun of Southern people? A little draw there? It's not fair. From Jersey? All right. I apologize. Don't nobody here talk like that. Who here talk like that? You? I was just playing. Right? So it's being bathed in power. So look, this is the difference. In his case, he had to get in the pool. Imagine having a pool inside you. In that case, he had to get in the pool, right? Imagine having a pool inside you. Rivers of living water, John chapter 3, 37 through 39. A well of water in you, John chapter 4, verse 14. Imagine having that pool in you where you could just draw on that power. See, when you're feeling depressed, you can draw on that power. When you're feeling infirmed, you can draw on that power. When you're feeling fearful, you can draw on that power. You can pray in the Holy Spirit. It says it builds you up in your most holy faith. Jude chapter 20 says praying in the Holy Spirit builds you up in your most holy faith. You got the pool in you. But it's not supposed to just be sitting dormant. You don't just have power available. You want it to fill you up. So somebody just bump, spills over it. God can make you the top person on your job and the top person in the house and the top person in the church and the top person at the gym. Top person in sales. Top person just walking down the street in the mall. I don't know who you are, but I see you and there's something on you and I need it. You think I'm playing? Gotta do that. I see you out yesterday. Somebody, these people took her to a church. Are you looking for a church? Hey, follow us. I just feel like I need to do something. Sister Debbie, praying for a house. Just praying for a house because the people that she's living with, she's renting a house. They was, well, we're going to sell a house. So you're going to have to move. So we praying. Guess what? They came to her and said, my daughter said, we just can't do it. We just can't do it. You can stay. See, power. God's trying to do, he's trying to work power. He's trying, God to do some things you wouldn't believe. If he just, look, you're willing and obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. The message says, if you only let me help you, I'll make you rich in every aspect of your life, not just money. Every aspect of your life. See, he's trying to pour that power, right? All right, so this is the thing. God wants to put all his power in us. And this is the thing. But we got to empty out all this other crazy stuff. We got to let go. So a lot of times you go through the, what's the song? The pressing, the beating, what song is that? What song is it? Greater. Greater is coming, right? And so you talk about the pressing, the beating, you talk about the olive, right? You go the pressing, the beating. You go through all that, but it's trying to get the oil out, right? Well, that represents the anointing. So look, the scripture says in Hebrews 12, it talks about the chastening of the Lord. Right, he says, those he chastens, he loves. But it says he chastens you, right? So to convert you into holy, so you can enter into his rest. So he wants you to be ready for his power. So he's beating out what's restricting the power. The scripture says, except a corner we fall to the ground and got die, can't bring forth fruit. So again, it has to be broke. That seed is pressed, it's broken, and it releases what's in it. So we go through brokenness or not, we think it's a punishment. No, it's trying to break your will to release that spirit man in you, that power in you. That's why we're going through stuff, but we're trying to get around it. Whoa, almost broke me, man. I got away from that one. Whoa, almost broke me. I'm still standing. I done saved face. Yeah, yeah. All you're doing is running from, you're protecting your will and your natural man, and you're to keep your spirit man suppressed. You're just running from what it takes to release the power in you. The Bible says, beat a child and they shall not die. Proverbs 13. Beat the child. I know this is gonna be tough with Tatum, he's so cute. But I'm gonna tell you how I learned it. You know, because my daughter-in-law called me one time. She says, okay, so this whole if my kids are messing up, do I spank them? I said, well, the Bible says, beat the child and shall not die. I knew what the effect was going to be, but I just wanted to say it. Right? She says, I said, so I use child CPR because she researched how to care for her children before she got them. Child CPR, stuff like that. Well, when I took child CPR, they had the baby. It was a fake baby. And you know, something's lodged in the throat, you had the thrust. So I was going like this. And the instructor was like, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm thrusting. She says, no, you got to thrust. I said, no, but I don't want to break the baby. She says, do you want the baby to die? You got to thrust to dislodge what could kill him. So would you spank your child if you knew that if you didn't, they die? So look. So God's chastening is so you don't die. He's trying to release what's in you. He's trying to get the power out, man. He's trying to get the power out. Some of y'all need to get some retroactive spankings. So at the end of the service, I'm going to be at the door. I have my belt out. If you missed out on a few spankings, just come by. You know, we drive out with restricting the spirit. Not a problem. I have no problem with, you know, being of service. We'll start with Terrell. Probably haven't had a spanking in 35 years. He ain't even 35 years old yet. So Terrell be first. See who else need a spanking here today. Jamal, you can be after him. Just bring your wife with you. I just do a family deal. Right? Alright, so just take the time out, you guys, to open yourself up, to take it's time to go to another level, okay? It's time to go to another level. You hear people, churches talk about revival all the time. It's not an individual thing. It's actually corporate, but it starts with individuals. And it's everybody yielding to the things of God. And I just want to challenge us to yield to the things of God. Scripture says you can't put new wine in old wineskins. Right? New wine, the Holy Spirit, you can't put. And then the reason why is because if you put new wine and old wineskins back in the day, the old wineskins would burst because they had already expanded as far as they could go. So God's trying to pour out a spirit on you, but you gotta cleanse out that old stuff. You gotta let go of some things, all right? Because he wants to endow you with power so you can live the fulfilling life that he had planned for you. God wants you to be fulfilled more than you do. So that's why we spent time talking about the Holy Spirit and cleared up all the mysteries, because people have been so confused about it. But it's power. Like, why would you look at power as an option? Right? When that's what you're fighting for. You don't want to be afraid no more, do you? There's certain, like stop all that shy stuff. That's not God. That's pride. Right? But when you have power, you don't even thinking about what people want to think. You just do stuff. I'm up here talking to you. Listen, I wasn't talking to nobody. I wasn't going to talk to nobody in front of nobody in high school, in college. Even when I first started going to church and I had to do announcements for my basketball program, I was like, man, I go up there and talk. I'd be praying all day. And then they kept changing it. They would just keep moving me down, you know, because, you know, the spirit would be flowing. They would change. I'm like, man, I was ready. Now they're going to move it down later on and I still got to speak. Okay, I'm going to say this. I'm going to say that. The same guy. The only difference now is the Holy Spirit. Not, I ain't no sweeter and I have no more confidence. It's the Holy Spirit. It's, look, it's floating. So I may haven't learned how to swim and learn how to float on water, but I float in the Spirit. And that's what God wants us to do. Stand on your feet. That's enough.
Thanks for tuning into today's broadcast. To view videos or make donations, feel free to access our website at www.heirscc.org. Remember, at Heirs, we believe we're just what you prayed for.